Thank you. Why should I thank you? Thank you all for being here, and welcome. It's a really great pleasure to have seduced John O'Keefe and Tim Bliss to leave their institutions and come to this one. It seems to me ironic that how institutional places can be. John works 500 yards from here, and you could get to Tim's place in 20 minutes. And I always think that the intelligent way to get an education in London is to take little account of the institution you belong to and make use of all the others. So today this favours us. Slightly daunted by their subject, I was trying to think of something that was local that everybody could relate to. And it had occurred to me that 30 years ago, Tottenham Court Road sold furniture, and it didn't sell anything else. And then suddenly it started to sell electronic things. And that it's a street that is almost devoted to memory, recording things. It's a particular pleasure that you're going to talk about the one that we carry around with us, and we're such short distance from this legion of equipment that afterwards you might all like to go out and buy yourself a new video recorder, tape recorder, computer, fax machine, or whatever. John is going to start, and he's told me that he prefers a five-hour lecture, and I suggested that you might not, but we don't know that. The difficulty with this is that there's a kind of game going on between John and Tim, and I don't know how long they wish to talk for or how they want to put this together. John's going to go first, Tim's going to make signals, Tim will follow him. Tim said that if there were things you didn't understand, you should ask, because he said if one person doesn't understand, it probably follows the whole room doesn't. So be the brave one. John O'Keefe.
Well, thank you very much, Richard, and thank you very much for coming. Tim and I are going to do a double act, and at the end of this double act, we hope you'll know everything you need to know about the brain, or at least everything you need to know about spatial memory and the way in which it's encoded in the brain. I'm going to spend most of my time showing overheads. I wonder, can I turn this around? Right about there. Okay, so I'm going to tell you about the way in which the brain represents space, the parts of the brain that are involved in representing space, and how different parts of the brain represent space differently. So my title is How the Brain Constructs Space, and what I've put up here are a couple of the key ideas that I'd like to get across throughout the talk, and that I hope you'll take away with you. First idea that we think is an important one for understanding how the brain represents space is the idea that there are two very distinctly different ways in which you can find your way from one place in the world to another. And we think that the brain honors this distinction. And I've called these routes and maps. And I'll tell you a bit more about what the distinctions are and how we think they're mapped onto the brain. At least part of the difference between these two is that they code for the spatial relationships of objects, either in terms of egocentric frameworks or in terms of allocentric frameworks. And I'll come back to that. Routes and their representation in egocentric frameworks are good for perceiving the world, the immediate world around you, and for acting on it. Maps and this more abstract notion of allocentric spaces are more appropriate for storing information and for remembering things. And I'll try to make the case that the part of the brain called the parietal cortex is particularly involved in roots, and the part of the brain called the hippocampus is particularly involved in maps. That's not to say that they don't cooperate and interact with each other, and we'll talk about that as well. But just that one is more important for representing one type of space than the other. Can you hear me all right at the back there? Yes. Okay, the structure of my talk is as follows. After I tell you a little bit about the idea give you a little overview of brain structure, I'll start with some experiments in which one uses functional imaging techniques, the latest brain scanning techniques, to see which parts of the brain are active during navigation. And this will show up both the hippocampal areas and the parietal areas. And then we'll take it from there. I'll use that as a springboard. I'll then discuss how this area called the parietal cortex might be involved in egocentric space, and the main body of data there will come from patients who have damage to this part of their brain. I'll then go on to the hippocampus and its role in allocentric space, and again we'll discuss very briefly patients who have damage to that part of their brain, and then we'll talk a little bit about work done in animals in the rat and what this tells us about this part of the brain. And finally, since some of the work on the hippocampus points towards it having a slightly larger function than just being specifically spatial, and perhaps a more general memory function, I'll talk a little bit about how what I've said in the earlier part relates to its memory function, and particularly to this idea of episodic memory. And this will act as a bridge to lead into Tim's presentation. To begin with, then, let me just discuss this idea that there are two basically different ways in which you can find your way around the world. Richard has already talked about Tottenham Court Road. Let us say that we wanted to give instructions to someone how they would get from this room to Tottenham Court Road. There are two basically different ways in which you could do this, and we think they are conceptually different and that they are instantiated in the brain in different ways. Call them routes and maps. A route is really a set of stimulus-response chains in which you link together a set of stimuli or features in the environment with a response that you have to make in order to get there. So you might say, to get from here to Tottenham Court Road, go out the front door, i.e. when you see the door, go out through it. Then you're on the street, you turn left, and the corner turn left, and so on and so forth. As opposed to this, there is a different way you could give instructions. You could actually pull out a map, and you could say, well, here you are on the map. Here's Tottenham Court Road. What you have to do is you have to head in this direction. And of course, you would point in the correct direction, but of course, they couldn't actually go that way because there is a wall in the way. So they would have to actually use the map and their understanding of the world to calculate how one would go between where they are on the map at present to where they want to go in the map, their goal. And of course, they could go by many different routes. So one of the things you can do from a map is you can extract many potentially different routes to go from one place to another. So route instructions are things like turn left at the corner, follow that cab, keep the tower on your right, as opposed to map instructions, which are go to a particular place, head north, leave this place. And the idea of a map calls up immediately a whole set of abstract concepts, the idea of places, the idea of directions, the idea of distances. And these are not, as I will show you, reducible to a particular simple set of features in the environment. Routes tend to be action-oriented. Maps, as I said, are memory-oriented. Routes are very rigid. If you're following a route and trying to go from one place to another and you get lost, it's very, very hard to find your way back. It's almost impossible to get back unless you happen to come back across the route. Maps, on the other hand, are much more flexible. You can get lost, pull out your map, and as long as you can identify your present location, then you can find your way to your goal. And as I said, in general, we think that routes relate to this part of the brain called the parietal cortex, and maps relate to the hippocampus. Okay, well, where are these areas? Here's a standard structure of the brain. And as you all know, the brain, the human brain, has all sorts of curvatures, fissures, and foldings, and so on and so forth. It's a way of trying to increase the surface area. And over the years, anatomists have parcellated the brain into lots of different sub-regions, and I've shown these here in different colors. So at the back, the posterior part of the brain here is the occipital cortex, or the visual part of the brain. At the front is the large frontal areas, which have something to do with planning and some of the higher cognitive functions. Down here is the temporal lobe, and here are the parietal lobes. Here's the parietal lobe here, shown in yellow, and here's the temporal lobe in green. And these are the two areas that we'll be concentrating on, because the area which is involved in egocentric, root-like space is very likely to be this parietal area here. And the area that's involved in the allocentric, map-like space is in the temporal lobe here. This is the parietal cortex. Again, anatomists have parcellated it down into smaller and smaller subdivisions. The area that we're particularly interested in is this area called 7 here, and I'll show you some of the effects of damage to that area in a moment. The hippocampal area is deep inside the temporal lobe and shown here. And you have to dig inside of the temporal lobe in order to see it. It's not exposed on the surface. Hippocampus means seahorse. Anatomists in the 15th century thought it looked like a seahorse. I think it looks more like a sad worm. Perhaps Tim will tell us why it's called a seahorse. Anyway, that's the hippocampus, and that's the other area we'll be talking about. Okay. How do we study it? There are lots of different ways in which we can study these parts of the brain. The way I'd like to start with, that I'd like to introduce our discussion, is the use of functional imaging experiments. These are experiments in which you look for the activity of the human brain during various experimental tasks. Now, this is fine if you're interested, and easy if you're interested in asking somebody something about language, looking at the brain areas involved in language, or even simple perceptual tasks. If you're interested in how the brain handles space, it becomes a little bit more difficult. How do you get somebody to activate the parts of their brain which are involved in, say, navigation or finding their way around the world? Well, in fact, what we tend to do is one of two things. You can ask people to imagine that they're going from one place to another, and I'll show you the results of that experiment. Or, more recently, what our group has been able to do is to use virtual reality techniques, in which you use virtual reality so that people think or can actually move about in a virtual world. And I'll show you a film of a little bit of what our virtual reality world looks like, and then we'll see which parts of the brain are active in these circumstances. Okay, could I have the first slide, please? Okay, the first experimental result I want to tell you about is a can you just run through those? Just keep going until I tell you to stop. Is an experiment that was done by Eleanor McGuire and her colleagues over at Queen Square. Yes, that's it. What Eleanor realized is that there exists in the world a group of people who are fantastic in terms of their ability to find their way around space. And they are London taxicab drivers. They spend years acquiring a very, very detailed map of London, and it's renowned throughout the world that you can get into a cab, ask the driver to take you from where they happen to be to any other place, and they'll do it. So Eleanor scanned the brains of taxicab drivers during an experiment in which they were asked to imagine that they were in their cab and that two passengers had just gotten into the cab and they were going to two different destinations, and they had to find the most efficient route to go between the two destinations. And then so the cab driver said, well, now I'm going from Piccadilly Circus and I'm going up the mall and so on and so forth. And what's shown here is the parts of the brain that are activated under those circumstances. Is there a pointer here, do you think? No, don't worry about it. I'll just talk you through it. And what you can see, if you look at the upper left figure here, which is a side view of the brain. Oh, terrific. What you can see here is that one area here is this area in the parietal cortex. So while cab drivers are trying to find their way around and plotting their course, they light up the parietal cortex, and shown in a different section, in a section which takes is a coronal, what's called a coronal section, is shown the other area we've been discussing, which is the hippocampus. So both areas are activated during this task, showing that both are involved. Now the problem with this task is, A, you have to rely on the subject saying, okay, well, I'm finding my way around the world, and that's in fact what they're doing. And you have no behavioral measure, so you can't say how good a job they're doing. What you would really like is you'd like to be able to have them find their way around the world, measure how well they're doing, and then see if which parts of the brain are being active as well. The second thing is that you can't tell whether they're using a route or a map in this experiment. So the next experiment I'm going to tell you about is one in which we look at, use the same strategy, look at brain activity during a wayfinding task in a virtual reality environment, and then try to dissect out whether the person is finding their way using a route, that is using this follow a particular trail strategy, or whether they're trying to find their way using some sort of a map-like structure. So what we've done is we create a virtual reality environment. It's a fairly large environment. It's about 70 meters by 70 meters. It consists of several streets. I can actually give you an overhead plan of it, although that won't be very informative. Can you turn off the slides, please? It consists of several main streets shown here, lots of shops, cinema, various shops that you can go into, such as a bookshop, several bars, and so on and so forth. The subject actually explores the environment for as long as they like, usually a half an hour, until they think they know it. Then their brains are scanned while they're asked to go from one particular place in the environment to another. They move around the environment using a joystick so that they can move all over the place. They can move fast, they can move slow, they can make left turns, they can make right turns. Could we have the film now? Well, the film shows us about the first minute or two of one of my colleagues, Neil Burgess, who actually created the environment, finding his way around the town. I hope. We looked at lots of different graphics packages to try and create this environment. We looked at many of the packages that are used, for example, in our architectural school. We've looked at all sorts of things. In the end, what we've settled on is a video game. It's now possible to take one of these video games, which involve running around, shooting up lots of monsters, and creating all sorts of mayhem, and using the editor that comes with it to strip out the monsters. So it's politically correct. It's to some extent fairly anodyne and not terribly interesting, unless you're interested in finding your way around the environment. How are we doing on the film? You just have to put it in. Okay, it's probably not crucial. I think what we need to do then is, perhaps we could show it during the discussion. It's I just thought you might be interested in seeing how realistic it is. Look, and you could see him right there. Did you see that? No. Perhaps we can just go back to the slides then. turn. If you show videos, you know I better bring a few slides. This is what it looks like when you first enter the environment. And you can see that you have things like, this is one of the main roads, and there's a road leading off there. Here's the bookshop that you can see. If you go down to the crossroads here and look down, what you get is a long view down here. And since it's based on the suburb of LA, you get a burning trash can here. You can also, if you look off into the distance, you can see buildings and hills in the distance. So you get a rather good impression of deep space. You can go into any of the buildings that you want. You can go down into an underground station, and there's a train that comes in and out. You can't go into the train. You can go into other buildings. There's a bank. And what I'd like you to notice here is that dotted around the various rooms and buildings are security cameras, another sign that it's Los Angeles. And these security cameras are linked up to video screens, which will show you the view of that room when you get there. Also dotted around here are arrows, which which you can use to instruct the subject to follow a trail of arrows. So in one condition, we ask them to remember where they are and find their way using their internal representation. In another, we just say follow the arrows. Here's one of the video screens. And when you go up to that and press it, it shows you the view, and that tells you where you're supposed to be. When we do that, we now are in a position to compare the brain areas that are activated when a person is trying to find their way around this environment by following a set of arrows, that is, using the route strategy, and ignoring, as it were, where they are in terms of any map-like structure. When we do that, what we find is activation in this parietal part of the brain here. That is, when we try to use a route strategy to find your way around the brain, you activate the parietal cortex, and you don't activate the hippocampus. If you now look at the other strategy, the one in which you actually try to find your way around by saying, where am I? How do I get to this location? How do I calculate a route based on some map-like representation? Then you light up the hippocampus. Not shown here is that you also, in that circumstance, light up the parietal cortex, but to a much lesser extent. So it's emerging from these experiments that even if you have a map-like representation of an environment, in order to use it, you have to get it out into an egocentric representation. In order to be able to move in space, you have to get the activation and the representation into the parietal cortex. And I'll come back to that in a second. I think I'll skip this. Let's show that during the discussion. I think there it is. Just a few seconds. So there we are, moving around. This is a bar. As you move around, you can see the arrows on the floor. You can move through the rooms internally, or you can go out into the main street. Here's a bookshop. We've taken all of the top shelf magazines off the rack. You can go out into the street here. Aside from anything else, this gives you a fairly good insight into youth culture as it's developing. You can go into, this is the back of the bank, and as you can see there are arrows on the floor and so on and so forth. I think that's probably enough. Thank you. Okay, what I'd like to do now is tell you a bit about how we go about finding out what, in detail, these two parts of the brain are doing. Let's concentrate first on this area called the parietal cortex, shown here. And let's ask what happens to an unfortunate patient who has either a vascular stroke or a tumor which damages this part of the brain, and particularly if you damage it on the right side. there seems to be a difference whether it's on the left or right side. Well, what you find is that these patients seem to be unaware of the left side of space. They quite often ignore their limbs. They quite often ignore stimuli that are on the left side of their in their visual field. And in fact, they seem to be totally unaware of the fact that the left side of their egocentric space exists. It's as though they have only half of their perceptual field. And the simplest way to show this is just to ask them to draw simple objects. So if you get them to draw simple things like a clock or a house or a flower, what you typically get is that they're very good at representing the right side of the figure, but they completely ignore the left-hand side. So they're good at writing the numerals down here, but then they might get one numeral on this side, and then they ignore all the rest. The left half of the house just doesn't exist. Now, they're free to look wherever they want. They just don't look over there, and they just, even when they look over there, they don't attend to what they're seeing over there. And finally, if you give them a flower, they'll only draw half of the flower. Now, you might think this is just some sort of a perceptual field deficit. But as I'll show you in a moment, it applies not only to space that you can perceive, but space that you call up in your imagination. Well, what's happening here? Well, one of the things that a lot of experimentation has suggested is that we need to think about these spaces not as a single unified space, but in terms of a whole series of spaces. And we need to think about egocentric spaces, which are spaces mapped onto the body surface and which travel with the body surface or aspects of the body, and allocentric frames of reference, which stay behind, as it were. So if we look at this chap here, and I apologize, he's not a very nice-looking chap, looking down at the top with his eyes pointing in this direction, and these are supposed to represent his shoulders, and this his head. When he's looking ahead with his head centered, like that, then we can imagine that all of these frames of reference, the frame of reference centered on the eye and the head and the body, are all in alignment and pointing in a particular direction. They're all lined up. So that if there's an object A over here, he then says, well, that is about 45 degrees in any one of these frames of reference. On the other hand, if we now say, well, move your eyes and turn your head so that you look over here, what we've done is we've dissociated the different frames of reference. And when we do this, we see that some areas in the parietal cortex are mapping the stimulus relative to the eye center frame of reference, some are mapping it relative to the head center frame of reference, and some are continuing to map it into the body centered frame of reference. So one of the things that the parietal cortex is doing is it's taking information coming in, say, from the eyes, where things are located relative to an eye-centered frame of reference, and they're transforming it into successively a head-centered frame of reference and then a body-centered frame of reference. All of these frames of reference are what we would call egocentric. They all travel with the body as the body moves. They can be dissociated from each other by these sorts of simple experiments. On the other hand, there are a whole set of other frames of reference, which are what we would call allocentric frames of reference, other centered frames of reference. They include reference frames which are fixed onto the environment, so that one could take, for example, the walls of the environment and say that A was fixed relative to these two walls and B was more closer to this wall. And that frame of reference is one which doesn't change as you move around. It stays stationary, and it's fixed onto the environment itself. There's also some suggestion that there are frames of reference which are fixed onto objects, so that one could talk about where one object is relative to another object. It's to the right of that object. So the parietal cortex, then, seems to be primarily involved in this operation of localizing stimuli in the world in terms of frames of reference. And that's exactly what you need to have if you were going to act upon a stimulus. If you were going to reach out and grab this A here, you'd need to have representations of where it was relative to the eye and where it was relative to the head, and so on and so forth. What seems to be happening in these parietal patients is that something goes awry with the way in which these frames of reference are fixed onto the body surface. If you imagine that in a normal person, they have, and this is to some extent metaphorical, they have a screen which represents their visual field or their head-centered field, then it tends to be fixed in this symmetrical way relative to the body axis. In these patients, what seems to have happened is that there's a big rotation in the field, such that most of their field and most of their frame is now over on the right-hand side. So that objects which would have been located on the field in a normal person are now located off the field, and that's why they seem to disappear. So there's this notion developing that there are these frames of reference and that they are somehow or other mapped onto the body surface, and that's an active process, and the process is done by the parietal cortex. Now, I said before that this is not just a problem in terms of perception, it's also a problem in terms of memory. Because you can show that these patients not only have difficulty in perceiving things that are on the left-hand of space, but if you ask them to imagine a scene, they also tend not to imagine the left-hand side of the scene. And this was done in a famous experiment by Bizziak and Luzzatti in 1978, in which they asked Italian patients to imagine that they were in a famous square in Milan, the Piazza del Duomo, which has a very large and famous cathedral and which everyone in Milan knows about, and to imagine that they were either standing on the cathedral steps and facing in the southward direction or standing at the other end of the square here and facing towards the cathedral. And what they found was that under those circumstances, when they were in this position, they, and told to ask to say what they could see all of these objects here, i.e. all the things on their right-hand side. When they were then asked to turn around and look in the opposite direction from here, they ignored and neglected all of these, and they talked about all of the things on this side. And that tells us two things. If you have something stored in memory about a particular area or a spatial layout, and you want to represent it to yourself, even to yourself, you have to call it out of some structure in the brain into the parietal cortex. And if the parietal cortex is damaged, then you can only call out the part of it that's on one side. It also tells us that they have the whole representation, because in order to be able to do this, they must have the whole representation of the entire square. They can only access part of it at a given time. So that tells us that there's another part of the brain which is involved in the representation of the entire part of the square. And that other part of the brain, we think, is the hippocampus. I just want to tell you in the next, take me about 5 or 6 more minutes, a little bit about patients who had damage to the hippocampus. This is the most famous patient who's been studied in the neuropsychological literature. He's known as HM. And he's a patient who had his hippocampus removed for the relief of epilepsy in the early 50s. And since then, he's been studied by many, many, many psychologists, mostly by Brenda Milner. And it's on the basis of the descriptions of this patient and what's wrong with this patient that we believe that the hippocampus is involved in, particularly in spatial memory, but perhaps also in a slightly larger category of memory, which I'll tell you about in a moment. So HM has great difficulty finding his way around the world. He has great difficulty with remembering where things are and with simple spatial tasks. I'll tell you about that first, and then I'll tell you about the slightly larger memory problems that he has. So if we look at a particular type of memory problem, let's look at this one. This is a very simple task, which has been given to HM and to many of these other patients who have removal or damage to these areas, in which you have a whole set of objects laid out on a tabletop. The patient is asked, can you tell me what the price of these objects are? They tell you the price of them, then the objects are removed from the tabletop, they're handed to the patient, and they're told, put the objects back in the same place that they were before. It doesn't really matter whether they know they're going to have to do this or not. It turns out that they're still hopeless at doing it. They can remember what the price of the objects are, they can remember what the objects are, but when they're actually asked to locate where the objects are, they're very poor at it. Okay, how are we doing? Okay, let me tell you a little bit about another way in which we can study this part of the brain, the hippocampus. Could I have the next slide? And what that tells us about how it is representing space. One of the things we could do is we can turn to an experimental model such as the rat, and we can ask what happens if the rat either has a dysfunctioning hippocampus, or we can ask the additional question, what happens if we look at the rat's brain while it's trying to find its way around the world? Can we see anything about the way in which the cells in the rat's brain work, which are telling us something about how it might be representing space? This is a simple task which was invented by Richard Morris in Edinburgh for testing the rat's spatial ability. What you do is you put the rat into a large swimming pool. Located in the somewhere in the swimming pool is a platform which the rat can swim to and climb onto. And the rat is motivated to do this. He's placed in different parts of the swimming pool, and he learns very quickly to swim to the swimming pool and climb on. If you do this a few trials, then and map where the animal swims, what you see is that a control animal, a normal rat, swims directly to the platform. Now you have to realize this platform is hidden below the surface of the water, so the only way the animal knows where it is to actually remember where the platform is relative to the objects in the room. Animals with hippocampal damage, shown here, are hopeless at doing this. They swim around and around and can't find their way to the platform and have to be removed after about a minute or so. If you make the simple change of raising the platform a small amount above the level of the water so that the animal can see it, then they swim very directly to it. If you can try lots of other types of memory tasks, and what you find is that these animals are very good at these other types of memory tasks. They seem to have a very special deficit in their ability to find their way around the world. Next slide. Thank you. An alternative thing that you can do is you can not cause damage to the hippocampus, but you can actually listen in on hippocampal cells and see what aspects of the environment they're responsive to. When you, and that's done the following year, take a very, very fine wire, you place it next to one of these cells in the hippocampus, and Tim will tell you a lot more about these cells in a moment, and place a wire which is many times smaller than the diameter of a hair next to the cell, and when you do that, you can listen in on the activity of one of these cells while the animal goes about its normal daily business. When you do that, you can then do the following experiment. You can place the animal in a box, very simple box, with a set of four walls, and let the animal wander around in the box. You can motivate it to move a bit more by throwing in little pellets of food, which it then chases around looking for, and plot where the animal goes in the environment, and then, in addition, plot where one of these cells becomes active. And what you see is shown in the fine line here is the trace of an animal recorded over many, many minutes as it moves around this box searching for the small pellets of food. Shown in red is the firing of this cell that we're listening into in this particular experiment. What you can see here is that during most of the time, the cell is completely quiet. And it's only, with the few odd exceptions, when the animal goes over into this corner that the cell becomes active. And you can show that kind of pattern of firing in this false color map here, showing the rates of firing as a set of false colors. Now, by looking and listening to these cells and looking at several of them at the same time, one gets a picture of what this particular part of the brain is interested in the rat. And what you find, shown on the next slide, for example, is that although the cell wants to fire in a particular part of the environment, it doesn't particularly care how the animal is facing in that part of the environment. So if a cell is firing in this southeast corner here, it will fire there if the animal runs in the eastward direction, in the westward direction, northward direction, the southward direction. And it's evidence such as this which suggests that what the cell is mapping is not just the presence of some stimulus in the environment, but the more abstract concept of place. And I won't go into the evidence for this, but it looks as though cells in this part of the brain are mapping abstract concepts about space. These cells are mapping concepts about place. Another set of cells are mapping the idea of direction and will fire when the animal points in the northward direction, irrespective of where it is in the environment. So it's the converse of this type of response. This says, I don't care which direction you're pointing in, I want to know where you are. The other cells respond when the animal is pointing in a particular direction, say north, irrespective of whether it's in the left-hand side of the box or the right-hand side of the box. Slides off, please. So let me then summarize. So what we think this part of the brain is doing in the rat, and probably also on the basis of other evidence in the human, is that it's providing the animal with a map, which is where we started. It creates the concept of place. Different cells respond to different places in the environment, and when you look at enough of these, they map the entire environment. It also provides the information about the relationship between places. So it will tell the animal when it's in a particular place, as represented by these place cells, and facing in a different direction, that if it moves a certain distance, both of which again are abstract concepts, which I don't have time to go into, it will end up in another place. And we think that this is the basis for the concept of a map. And that with a map like this, just as you can find your way to Tottenham Court Road from one place to, from here, to Tottenham Court Road by any of many different routes. So given this kind of a map-like structure, if an animal is at A, it can find its way to B either directly along this route here or it can go via C. It has that kind of rich information which will support many different flexible routes. Okay, my time is out. So let me just summarize. The brain represents space in several different ways. And I've told you about allocentric versus egocentric types of representation. And as far as we can tell so far, it honors the distinction that we make intellectually between these different ways of finding one's way around the world. So that different parts of the brain actually represent different types of space. And specifically, the parietal cortex provides the egocentric frameworks, and these are very useful for perceiving space, for taking space out of long-term memory, spatial representations out of long-term memory, and actually putting them in a form that they can be acted on or talked about. And that those long-term representations, the long-term memories are stored in the hippocampus, which we think provides an allocentric cognitive memory map, and that in the human, this is to some extent used for navigation and the representation of the spatial environment, but it does other things as well. And just in closing, and as a pointer to Tim's talk, it looks as though in the human, if you take this basically spatial representational system and you add things like time to it, you add the notion of linear time, that is the time which goes from the past in a unidirectional way to the future, and you put spatial representations with a temporal tag, then what you have is something what would mostly be called an episodic memory or event memory system. Event memories, your ability to say what you did yesterday, what you had for lunch the day before that, seem at least in part to be based on your ability to know where you did it and when you did it. So we think that in the human, this system, which is basically a spatial system in animals, has come to have a much broader function, a memory function, which is roughly called episodic or event memory. And Tim will tell you all you need to know about the cellular basis of memories. Thank you. What do you want on? I'll leave that on.
You want to take the pointer? Not the cup. Oh, you want to turn it on?
Yeah, that's okay.
Right, well, John said I was going to tell you about the cellular basis of episodic memory, the kind of memory which is interesting to us because we can talk about it. Well, what I'm going to be talking about may be related to episodic memory. One hopes it is, but it's a bit of a long jump, and I'm not really going to be talking about memory as such, and I'm afraid at this point, if the door was open, there would be a rush for it, because what I find is that when people ask me what I do, and I say, well, kind of long story short, I work on memory, and then I go into, well, actually, I record electrical activity from rats and so on, people get markedly less interested. And what people really want me when they say they're interested in memory is that they are interested in having a better memory, and where's my pill? And, you know, I work at an institute called the National Institute for Medical Research, where no medical research, so far as I know, has ever been done. But one hopes that in the long term, the kind of research which I'm going to be talking about will lead to the development of useful pills, because unless you know how memory works when it works normally, how can you make it, how can you improve it? So it all begins with our friend the hippocampus, about which we've just heard a good deal from John. In fact, if we step back a bit and ask, how could the brain, consisting as it does of vast numbers of nerve cells, highly interconnected, how could a system like that, a biological system like that, how could it store information? The brain changes moment by moment as we go through life and store new memories as we acquire information and so on. So the brain today is different from the brain yesterday. It is a different structure. It must be different in some way. Molecularly, synaptically, it's a different structure. What does that mean? It stores information. How can it do it? Well, if you think about how the brain operates, nerve cell, it consists of individual nerve cells which are linked by synapses. Nerve cells are devices which you can think of as being all or none switches. They fire nerve impulses or they don't. There's no in between. And when they fire a nerve impulse, that's to say a nerve impulse travels down its axon to excite or inhibit other nerve cells. It does that in an all or none way. The actual amplitude of the nerve impulse doesn't change. So it doesn't look like you can store information by changing the amplitude of nerve impulses. You've got to do it in some other way. And the obvious way to do it, and it's so obvious that it's been believed that this is where information is stored in the brain, the basis of memory, is at the synapse. And that's being believed because really, how else could it work? And the synapses are the junctions between nerve cells. These are not all or none. A nerve impulse, when it arrives at a nerve terminal, releases a chemical transmitter which diffuses across the tiny space, and it is a space between one nerve cell and the next. When it arrives at the target cell, it interacts with receptor proteins embedded in the membrane, opens ionic channels, allows ions to flow into the target cell, and that reduces or increases the electrical potential across the nerve cell. And nerve cells fire when that electrical potential is reduced to some threshold value. So to fire a nerve cell, you've got to reduce the electrical potential across it.
and you do that by synaptic activation. So, we experience an event that's transduced by the sensory apparatus to into nerve impulses. What the brain knows about the external world is all encoded in patterns of nerve impulses. And so if you're going to remember that event, that pattern of nerve impulses must itself be the agent of change. So we come to the idea of activity-dependent changes in synaptic strength. Somehow or other, neural activity must itself be able to change the strength or efficiency of synapses. And this idea is embedded in a famous postulate due to the Canadian psychologist Donald Hebb, who taught at the university where both John and I were at, McGill University in Montreal. And Hebb's postulate, published in a book called The Organization of Behavior in 1949, is in my first slide. Can I have the first slide, please? I have to turn it on. It's about three. Yes, here we are. Okay, so here's Hebb's postulate, and it's a very simple postulate. It simply says that if you consider two nerve cells A and B, and A projects to B, so if the axon of cell A is near enough to excite cell B, in other words, projects to cell B, and if nerve cell A persistently fires at a time when nerve cell B is also firing, if A and B fire together, then the synaptic strength between those two cells will be strengthened. Now that idea that coincident activity is what's important for strengthening synaptic connections has been a very potent one, and that's probably one of the most influential statements that any psychologist has ever made. The problem has been that in 1949, and indeed for several decades thereafter, no such sign of such synapses, of cells obeying Hebb's postulate, could be found in the brain. And it wasn't until the late 60s that synapses in the hippocampus were found to possess a property which looks suspiciously like a Hebb synapse. And that's really what I'm going to be talking about. Hebb synapses as they appear in this structure which we know is important for memory, the hippocampus. And the hippocampus is important in rats as it is in humans. And the organization, the cellular organization of the hippocampus is very similar in man and rats. So the next slide just reminds you where the hippocampus is in humans. It's this structure tucked in the inside of the temporal lobe. And in rats, can I have the next slide, please? If you take a section, a coronal section in this plane down through the head of a rat, then you find that the most striking structure is the hippocampus. This here is the hippocampus. So you see, it's a bilaterally symmetrical structure. In rats, it's nearer the top of the brain than in humans, where it's down here. And it consists of two tightly packed sorts of cells, which I'll describe in more detail in a minute. So let's have a look at the next slide, which gives a picture of one of the cells in the hippocampus. And this is a drawing of a so-called pyramidal cell. And the important thing to note about these cells is the richness of the connections which other cells make with it. And I hope you can see that, perhaps you can't at the back. But on each of these dendrites, as these receiving structures are called, here's the cell body, and all these, everything else that's drawn here that you can see comprises the dendritic tree of this cell, and it's onto these structures that other nerve cells project their axons, and as you can see, each dendrite is studded with these little projections which are called dendritic spines, And it's on these dendritic spines that you find the excitatory synapses from other nerve cells. So let's have a look at that in a bit more detail. Here's a picture of a single length of dendrite in a living cell, which is filled with a fluorescent dye. And you can see how thickly studded this dendrite is with these so-called dendritic spines. And it's on these spines that synapses are made. Next slide, please. If we look at those spines in the electron microscope, then what you see is something like this. This is something which takes a bit of training to actually interpret. It probably just looks like a complete mess to you. But if I just go around here, this is a cross section through a dendrite, all right? And here is a dendritic spine, which is a protuberance sticking out of the main body of the dendrite, which you can think of as a tube, which we've cut here in cross section. And here is a terminal made by a cell which is projecting to this dendrite. And it's projecting onto this dendritic spine, and it's packed with little round objects which contain the transmitter. And the actual specialized region where the receptor proteins are embedded is this thickened region here. So this is where all the synaptic action is taking place. And any one of these pyramidal cells can have thousands, indeed tens of thousands, of such spines. So even a single cell, and of course there are millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of cells in the brain, but each individual cell is itself a highly sophisticated and complex computing device. Right, so that's an electron microscopic picture of a single spine, of a single synapse. Can I have the next slide, please? So now I'm showing you a diagram of the wiring of the hippocampus. If you can throw your mind back using your sophisticated episodic memory system to about four slides ago, you'll recall that the hippocampus consists of two interlocking series of cells, which are shown here. These are the so-called granule cells, and these are the pyramidal cells, which we've just been talking about. And the hippocampus is very, apart from having these two tightly packed cell layers, also has a very cleanly organized system of fibers coming into it. So the perforant path, this PP here, brings in information from a region of the brain called the entorhinal cortex. It's highly processed, multisensory information. So information about the external world through all senses eventually gets to the hippocampus. And it projects via these axons or fibers here to the dendrites of these granule cells. And then we have another projection here and another projection here. And everything's so nicely laid out that this is an enormously popular preparation for neurophysiologists who are interested in the electrical properties of synapses and nerves, even if they're not in size but interested in memory. It's just a very convenient system. So in fact, we probably know more about the synapses of this region here than we do about any other synapses in the whole brain for that reason. Okay, the next slide shows you a picture of a chemical map, if you like, of these projections which I was just talking about. Here are those granule cells, and here are the pyramidal cells of the hippocampus. And these darkly stained regions are the nerve terminals, which have a slightly different chemical composition from the target cells, and so they stain this deeply black color. But the important thing is that you see that the granule cells project to these cells in a very tightly organized way. The dendrites of these cells actually extend all the way up here, but these axons are only interested and only terminate on a very precise proximal part of these cells. So the whole organization of the hippocampus is very tight, and that's important from an experimental point of view, because it means that that when you stimulate these axons which project to the hippocampus, the target cells all respond in a stereotyped way and give rise to large electrical responses which are easy to record. And so one of the other reasons why the hippocampus has been studied so intensively is not simply because it's a structure which we know is essential for forming episodic memories, memories of everyday events, but it's also a structure which is easy to work on, and that is by no means an unimportant consideration in experimental science. So the next slide shows you the kind of responses which you can record from this structure. So here are those granule cells, here are the perforant path fibers from the entorhinal cortex, and they terminate just in the middle of part of the dendritic tree of these cells. And if you put down an electrode into the brain here, into the hippocampus, and you stimulate electrically these perforant path fibers, so nerve impulses are traveling along the perforant path, and when they reach these target cells, when the impulses reach these target cells, they release chemical transmitter, and that excites these granule cells. It excites them in such a way that it reduces the electrical potential across the cell membrane, and when that electrical potential reaches a certain threshold value, as I said, then the cells will actually discharge nerve impulses. And you can see this happening here, because with weak shocks, where you don't activate many synapses, you get a synaptic response. It's a measure of these synapses being active and releasing transmitter, but you're not yet firing the cells. And you can see that because if you come down with your thin wire or glass electrode into the cell body region, which is about 100 microns below this synaptic region, then you also record a synaptic response, but it's a passive response. It's a mirror image of what's actually happening up here in the dendrites. But then if you increase the strength of your stimulus and activate more fibers, then the cells become more strongly activated, they become more strongly depolarized, and they actually start to fire. And because they're all packed together, all acting in the same way, a whole population of them will fire together. And that is seen down here on your recording electrode. There's a sharp spike superimposed on this synaptic response. So with this kind of technique, and you can do this either on brain slices, which are slices about half a millimeter thick, cut from the hippocampus and laid in an organ bath and perfused with a salty glucose solution, which will keep the slice alive for several hours. Or you can do this in the anesthetized rat, or you can even do it in freely moving animals. You implant electrodes in the rat under anesthesia, and then you allow them to recover, and a few days later you start doing experiments when they're awake and they are completely unconcerned by the fact that they have an electrode in their head, and you can record exactly the same kind of response. So you can actually look at synaptic activity in the behaving animal. So what we have here then is a measure of synaptic efficiency in this particular synaptic pathway, which is one of many excitatory pathways in the brain, but it's an identified pathway. I mean, we know where it is anatomically, and we know it's in the hippocampus, part of the brain that's important for memory. Now, if you stimulate this pathway just steadily, say once every second or once every 10 seconds or something, you'll get the same response every time. But it turns out that if you give a brief high-frequency train of impulses to these cells, so you've got a brief high-frequency train of action potentials coming along this pathway, which of course is entirely artificial, but you could imagine such a thing happening in real life as well, then you find that you produce a long-lasting, persistent change in the efficiency of these synapses, in the amplitude of the response which is evoked by the test shock. You've induced, as it were, an artificial synaptic memory in these synapses, and that's shown, I think, in the next slide, please. So here's an experiment of an early example of one of these experiments which I was doing in Oslo at the end of the 60s with a Norwegian colleague. Yes, this reminds me of a joke. I will come to this joke. Just bear with me. We only have 5 hours to go. The joke happens about here. What we were doing in this experiment then was to monitor the response of these synapses to activation, to standard test shocks. And I said that if you give these shocks at regular intervals, nothing happens throughout, that you can go to sleep. I mean, it stays the same for hours on end, and that's these open circles here. That's on one side of the brain, the hippocampus on one side of the brain being activated with constant test shocks every 30 seconds for hours on end. And it does sort of wander around a bit, but there's no long-term trend. On the other hand, on the other side, at the times marked by these arrows, we gave these brief high-frequency trains, and these can really be very brief, just a fraction of a second, just a buzz, pss, high-frequency trains. This is something which these synapses seem to be very interested in, because what happens is that immediately they increase their efficiency. They were down here, and now the same test shock at the end of this train, and you go back to giving these test shocks, it's suddenly increased, and it doesn't come back. And you give more and more shocks, and it just goes on and on. Eventually, it'll saturate. But now you see that you have created a vastly more efficient set of synapses than on the other side. So you have created a sort of synaptic memory of these interesting events marked by the arrows. Now, these are long-term experiments. They often went on late into the night, and this gap here represents the time when my friend Tarja Lermo and I were both apparently asleep. We didn't have computers in those days, so you had to watch a screen and mark down the amplitude of the response by hand. And I mean, you know, years later when we were looking back on this, saying, well, who was it actually who went to sleep at that? I mean, you know, because we had somebody was on watch, somebody was asleep. So the person on watch went to sleep. Now, who was it? Was it him or me? And, you know, I mean, anyway, I said it was unquestionably Tarja, because Norwegians were always falling asleep on the job. That's why there were so few of them. I haven't actually told Tarja that, but anyway. So this phenomenon has become vastly popular as a model for the neural basis of memory. And it turns out that it is, in fact, a very good exemplification of Hebb's postulate, for reasons which I will show in the next couple of slides. Can I have the next slide, please? So it's long-term potentiation, often called LTP, has these three properties, which, of course, all end in ITY, like all self-respecting properties. A cooperativity simply means that you give a high-frequency train to induce long-term potentiation. You reset the efficiency of these synapses. But it turns out that high-frequency train is not enough. You actually have to give... There's an intensity threshold, too. You have to activate enough of these axons. You just have to have enough axons. High-frequency trains to a single axon wouldn't work, we don't believe. So that was called cooperativity. But 2 and 3 are actually more important, and these are essential attributes of a Hebb synapse. Input specificity. Okay, imagine that you've got two inputs to a cell, or to a population of cells, two independent sets of nerve fibers projecting to a given target population. And let's say that one is weak and the other is strong. So that one is weak in the sense that it's below this cooperativity threshold. You give a high-frequency train to that weak one and you don't get long-term potentiation. But you give a high-frequency train to the stronger of the two and you get LTP in that. So input specificity says that if the only one that's active is that strong pathway, then only the strong pathway will be potentiated. So in inducing this form of synaptic plasticity, long-term potentiation, you're not strengthening all the synapses onto a given cell. It's just that subset of synapses which receive that high-frequency input. And obviously that enormously increases the the capacity of the cell as an information device, because it means that you can, in the limit, you can store information at the level of the single synapse. It's not stored throughout the target cell, just in those activated synapses. We started the video a bit prematurely, I'd say. Can we turn that off? Thanks. So associativity. Okay, let's go back to the weak and the strong. You've got these two pathways. The weak is too weak. You won't get LTP with the weak pathway, but you will with the strong. And if you just give the strong, then only the strong is potentiated. But what happens if you give the weak and the strong together? Well, it then turns out that if you do that, then you will also potentiate those synapses in the weak pathway. Even though if you give the high-frequency train to the weak pathway alone, you don't get potentiation. Now, if you think about what that means in terms of learning, it provides an immediate explanation at the synaptic level for classical conditioning, the kind of thing which Pavlov described at the beginning of the century. You remember his dogs, which salivated to the scent of food. If you ring a bell, they might pick up their ears, but they don't salivate. But if you always ring that bell, if you consistently ring that bell just before you give food, then before very long, they will start to salivate to the sound of the bell. Now, you can think of the bell as being the weak input to the salivary glands and the food being the strong input. Combine the two together often enough, and you strengthen the weak input, representing the auditory input from the bell, from the ear, and in that way, you've got an explanation for that very common sort of learning, associative learning, where you're just associating two things together. Things that happen at the same time tend to be associated in memory. So, for that reason, we believe, we can assert, I think, that these hippocampal synapses are Hebbian, and they're often referred to nowadays as Hebbian synapses. So it turns out that we now have, as a result of research in this area, we have a jolly good molecular explanation for these Hebbian properties. In other words, we can point to a particular protein encoded by a particular gene and say it's that gene, that protein, which endows these hippocampal synapses with these Hebbian properties. And I'll quickly run through the mysteries of the NMDA receptor, and I hope nobody will leave this room without the name of this receptor tripping lightly off their tongues. The NMDA receptor is quite the most fashionable receptor in the whole of neuroscience. Next slide, please. So we'll skip this one, which is just an experiment showing those properties of associativity and input specificity. And knowing those properties, you could, if you wanted, promulgate this induction rule for long-term potentiation, which is very similar to Hebb's rule, which says that a synapse will be potentiated if it's active at a time when the dendrite on which it's located is strongly depolarized, that's to say strongly activated. So a strongly activated synapse and a strongly activated target cell and an active synapse, if those two events happen at the same time, then that synapse will be potentiated. And I'd like you to note that if you want to go into the business of dreaming up rules for the brain, it looks much better in 12-point italic. Next slide, please. So now this NMDA receptor, I don't have time to go into any detail about it, but it's got some peculiarities, one of which is that it's voltage dependence, which means that its activation actually does critically depend upon the level of the voltage across the membrane. That actually is not true for most receptors. And it's that, it turns out, which gives it, allows it to give long-term potentiation these properties of input specificity and associativity. And the next slide shows the experiment, which was done by Graham Collingwood, who's now a professor in Bristol, which first alerted to us to the possibility that this particular receptor was intimately involved in the induction of this form of synaptic plasticity. You don't really need to know this, but I'll tell you anyway, that the transmitter substance, which diffuses across the synapse to excite the target cell when a nerve impulse arrives at the synapse, is glutamate. That's the excitatory a transmitter for all fast excitatory transmission in the brain. Now, what glutamate does when it arrives when it diffuses in a few hundred microseconds across that tiny synaptic cleft and acts on the presynaptic side of the synapse is determined by the receptors, the receptor proteins with which it interacts. And there are two sorts of receptors which are specialized for glutamate on the postsynaptic side of the synapse. One is this NMDA receptor, and the other is the AMPA receptor. And really, it's the AMPA receptor, at least in the hippocampus, that does all the work. Most of the time, the NMDA receptor is asleep because it just is. Okay, it's blocked by magnesium ions, but we don't really know that. It plays no role in the normal activity of these glutamatergic synapses. Yes, Peter.
Glutamate?
Yes. Glutamic acid is
sugary water comes to mind.
Monosodium glutamate?
Chinese food?
Yes. Yes. Don't eat too much Chinese food. It's a very common chemical. It's an amino acid. But it turns out, and it's so common that for years people refused to believe that such a common metabolic compound could actually be a transmitter. But it is. So here is this drug. Pharmacology works by finding drugs which block things. Antagonists are very important to pharmacologists. AP5 or APV is an antagonist of this NMDA receptor. As far as we know, it doesn't do anything else except block NMDA receptors. It's not a natural compound. It was invented, synthesized specifically for this purpose. And it's very good at it. It does block NMDA receptors. And you see that when you put on AP5, it doesn't actually do anything to the synaptic response. That isn't affected. Actually, you can't see that very well, but it's not. However, when you give this high-frequency train, which is what produces this sudden and persistent increase in synaptic efficiency, then you don't get it. It blocks that. You get a short-term increase, but no long-term increase. And then you wash this off, and you give the high-frequency train, and you get your sudden increase. And now if you give a drug again, it has no effect. So this drug blocks which blocks the action of the NMDA receptor, blocks the induction of long-term potentiation. And the next slide is a cartoon, which if I had time would explain all that. But I mean, basically what it's saying is that there are these two forms of receptor. Here's the presynaptic terminal. It's releasing the transmitter. The transmitter is diffusing across this tiny gap. It's interacting with these two sorts of proteins, the KQ, which is now called AMPA, and the NMDA. The NMDA is blocked by magnesium ions, so all the work is done by this glutamate receptor. But during a high-frequency train, the cell, the postsynaptic cell here, becomes so strongly depolarized that the magnesium ions are kicked out, and the NMDA receptor is channel opens up, lets in calcium ions, and cut a long story short, it's the entry of calcium ions through this specialized protein, which is a type of glutamate receptor. It's the entry of calcium through that channel, which sets off this process, which we call long-term potentiation. So we know quite a lot about the induction of this process, and why this particular receptor is so important for the induction of long-term potentiation. In fact, we know a good deal less about the mechanisms which keep these synapses potentiated for hours and days on end. It's probably not lifelong, at least not in this particular pathway. Maybe, indeed, it has to be, presumably, in some other pathways, but it certainly lasts for a very long time, long enough that we think that it must require the expression of novel genes. And there's a big hunt for that at the moment, and perhaps when we find the the novel genes, we'll find drugs which can interact with these genes and so give you superb recall of everything you want to recall and allow you to forget everything you want to forget. Right, so the next slide. How are we doing for time? Can I have 5 minutes? Next slide, please. Okay, now this is my rather smarter version. of John's slide. Well, of course, this was this. This shows you the Morris, the famous Morris water maze. Here's a mouse, a rat or a mouse. Actually, mice are not much good at this because they're so light they just float and they don't see the point. But rats don't like getting wet and they'll sink, and so they do swim around. And of course, when you first put them in, they've no idea what's going on, and they swim around at random, squeaking. And until eventually they bump into this invisible platform and then they climb onto it. And you do that enough times and eventually they learn where the platform is on the basis of external things in the external visual cues in the room. And then you can put them down at random anywhere here and they'll swim straight for it. So if we want to believe that this physiological phenomenon I've been telling you about, long-term potentiation, actually has something to do with learning, is it just an interesting model which keeps lots of neuroscientists employed, or is it actually something which the brain does use to store information? Well, that's something we'd very much like to know, and it's turning out to be a very hard nut to crack. I mean, one is trying to bridge two sort of separate levels of inquiry here. I'm talking about physiology. And now I want to try and link that to learning, to a cognitive function, and it's very difficult to produce really compelling evidence which would persuade everybody that long-term potentiation is what the brain makes use of to store information. But we can do experiments, and we can say, well, if long-term potentiation is what the brain uses to store information, and in particular in hippocampal dependent learning of this sort, then it better be the case that rats can't learn if you block the induction of long-term potentiation. And we were just talking about this drug, AP5, which blocks the NMDA receptor and is very efficient at blocking long-term potentiation. And so one of the experiments that Richard Morris, who invented this maze, did a few years ago, was to infuse AP5, the NMDA antagonist, into the hippocampus of rats and then test them on the water maze, and indeed they were pretty useless at it, and of course they were also useless at LTP. Well, I mean that's quite nice, but it doesn't actually prove the link. It's pretty suggestive, I suppose, but it doesn't prove it for various reasons, one of which is that while we know that AP5 blocks the NMDA receptor, and indeed it was designed to do that, we have no way of knowing that what else it might be doing. We don't think it does anything to ordinary synaptic transmission in the hippocampus. It's not blocking the flow of information through the hippocampus, but it may be acting on other structures which are important for learning. And we don't know where else it's acting either. I mean, we put it into the hippocampus, but you know, it leaks. So it's for that kind of reason which that we can't even now say for sure that long-term potentiation is the mechanism the brain uses to store information, but it's a pretty good guess. Actually, I like to quote that remark of Mark Twain's. There was a big debate in the 1880s or whatever about who wrote the Iliad. Was it Homer or was it not? And Mark Twain's view on this was that, well, if it wasn't Homer, it was some other blind Greek poet of the same name. And it has to be something like LTP, even if it's not LTP, because how else? I mean, really, you can't conceive of any other alternative. That doesn't constitute rigorous proof. So I've actually run out of time. But I do want to show my little movie, which actually shows you a synapse in action. So what I'm going to be showing you is a nerve cell which has been filled with a fluorescent dye which binds calcium. And when it binds calcium, it changes its fluorescence. And so this dye acts as a calcium indicator. It tells you when calcium is entering the cell. And I told you that the entry of calcium through the NMDA receptor is the trigger for the induction of long-term potentiation. So by using dyes of this sort, we hope eventually to be able to sort out some of the unresolved questions about the mechanisms for long-term potentiation. I mean, for instance, I've talked about the induction, which involves this NMDA receptor, which is located postsynaptically on those dendritic spines. But that's the induction. We don't know what happens then. And there are a number of ways in which you could imagine that a synapse could become more powerful. It could release more transmitter. That would be, if you like, a presynaptic process. Or it could be postsynaptic in that the cell could express more receptors at that synapse. Or maybe the synapses just get bigger and you have larger specialized areas into which you pack more receptors and on the presynaptic side you have more transmitter. Really, we don't know which, if any, of those is true. However, with this technique, we hope to be able to answer some of those questions. So what we're going to see then in the video, which only lasts about 30 seconds, I think, is we're looking for... we've got a cell which is filled with this calcium-sensitive dye. There's a bit of calcium in the cell anyway, so the cell is outlined, we can see. And we're stimulating electrically and with a double shocks, which you'll hear as bubba every few seconds on the soundtrack. And we're looking for spines which are responding to our stimulus. Okay? Now, we have no idea where these spines are. We know that some spines are responding because we can record electrically and know that we're getting a response, but we don't know from which of the many thousands of spines on this cell are producing that response. So you just have to search. So actually what happens is that we have a culture, a hippocampal culture, which is sitting on the stage of a microscope, and we're just moving the culture, which includes, of course, our labeled cell, under the objective of the microscope, and just going up and down the dendrites, looking for responding spines, looking for little flashes of calcium. And the movie will show you that. If you're lucky, you can find one. Okay, so can I have the slide off and that... okay, so here's the dendrite, and we're just getting into focus, and there's the sound of the stimulus, and we haven't seen anything, so we're moving down, and we're stopping here a minute, because maybe we saw something, yes. Now there's something there which looks, if you just look there, it looks like, is it responding? No, but on the other hand, look, there you see, it's spontaneously active. I don't think it's responding to our stimulus, but it's responding to something. See? You see it flash? That's thought in action. That's what's going on in all your heads now. It's responding at a rate, it's firing, this little spine here is being activated about once every 2 or 3 seconds in a random way. We don't actually know whether this is because it's receiving nerve impulses at that sort of rate. Okay, that's it, thanks. Or whether that's just completely spontaneous, because there are spontaneous events in which transmitter is released without an afferent, without a nerve impulse actually invading the nerve terminal, and that's sort of background synaptic noise. So anyway, that's that kind of technique. As I say, we hope will, because after we've induced long-term potentiation, if we can do that in that kind of preparation, then of course we'll be able to see whether the probability of a nerve impulse releasing transmitter and giving us a flash of calcium is higher, because that's one of the ways in which we can envisage long-term potentiation being encoded. It's a surprising fact, and just let me end on this, that neural transmission in the central nervous system is not a certain event. It's a probabilistic thing. At a single synapse, when a nerve impulse arrives at that terminal, it is not certain that it will release transmitter. There's a certain probability, which can be quite high, but it can also be very low. So for any given synapse, when we start the experiment, it might have a probability, say, of 0.5. On average, every other invading impulse releases transmitter. The other half just fail. And so one way in which you could get a stronger synapse is to increase that probability of release. And that's the kind of thing which we will be able to see with this technique, I think. Right, thank you very much.
There are a few minutes for a few questions. And I'll take what's known as the moistened plum. And I wanted to ask you I'd like to ask you both. Is that this thing about probability, could that be desire? I mean, what all through this I've been wondering about the idea of choice and pleasure and the things I want to learn about and things I don't want to learn about. So when you talked about this probability, I was wondering if you have any idea about what provokes that probability.
Well, I mean, I think that it's one way in which you can design a system which does have the capacity to change. It's one way in which you can get changes to change that probability. I mean, not all systems are have this. I mean, some systems, even in the brain, it's so important that the synapse work that the probability is one. It's certainly true in the peripheral nervous system and at the neuromuscular junction. It's no good being a concert pianist if every 50% of the time you hit B flat. It's got to work every time, and it does work every time. But in the brain, an organ in which information storage is one of its most important attributes, you've got to have mechanisms which will allow change to happen. So if there was no room for change, then you would not have a plastic system. Indeed, I mean, one of the ways in which people have addressed this question of whether long-term potentiation is important for learning is to say, well, let's drive these synapses to their maximum efficiency by doing repeated high-frequency trains. And then you've got a system which can't change. That animal should not be able to learn. And maybe those experiments have worked, maybe they haven't. It seems to be a difference of opinion. But that approach was a valid one. So, I mean, I think the answer is to be found in the need for flexibility in the brain.
Okay. I've got a question about the rat.
Yes. The pool, we call it. It's the swimming pool.
Does it need a point of reference? You said that when you put it back in, once we learned where the hidden
yes.
form was.
Yes. Yes.
Can it because the tank looked to me as if it was the same wherever you went in.
Yes, but what's not the same is what's